Okay, good morning. Morning, morning. Thank you for coming for the Rheumatology Friday presentation. It's going to be done by our consultant, Dr. Portici Boka, and she's going to touch on lupus and the heart, which is quite a broad topic. So we'll hear what she has to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Good morning, everybody. Okay, so first I'll start with the introduction. Cardiovascular disease and malignancies have been shown to be the leading cause of mortality worldwide. This is according to the World Health Organization. In sub-Saharan Africa, cardiovascular deaths have increased by 50% in the past 3 decades, largely due to increase in cardiovascular lifestyle diseases, namely hypertension, diabetes, and obesity. Therefore, it goes without any questions that treating risk factors for cardiovascular disease is more cost-effective than actually treating its complications. So, first, I will go through the history of. Before the history, cardiovascular comorbidities have been shown to be highly prevalent in patients with rheumatic disease. This is due to a high-grade systemic inflammation that is involved in the pathophysiology of these diseases, and also due to high dose and lasting doses of corticosteroid therapy that are used in these diseases. Firstly, I'll go through the history of lupus. It was first described as knowing dermatosis, and then later on, the term lupus, which in Latin means wolf, was described. This was because patients with lupus presented with these erosive skin lesions that looked like a bite of a wolf. Later in 1872, Kaposis now subdivided lupus into discoid and systemic, and he showed that systemic disease had potentially fatal outcomes. In 1954, hydralazine-induced lupus was described. And only in 1982 were ACR or American College of Rheumatology classification of SLE was published. During the period between 1964 and 1990, the treatment of severe lupus with high steroids and immunosuppressants was introduced. And only later on, the first biologic, being belimumab, was approved. The relationship between lupus and cardiovascular disease goes way back from the 1920s, and it was further described in the 1940s in autopsy studies. Okay, so going through the definition of lupus, it is a chronic autoimmune inflammatory disease. It presents with a wide spectrum of serological manifestation and clinical manifestation. And its pathophysiology involves immune complex deposition, autoantibody production, and complement activation. And the etiology is interaction between hormonal factors, genetic factors, and environmental factors. The slides here just shows a very simplified pathophysiology of lupus. Firstly, there will be loss in the adaptive immune tolerance. And in a genetically susceptible patient with environmental interaction, by environment, we mean either ultraviolet light or a viral infection, or a patient starts smoking. This leads to impairment of the immune system, and there will be impaired clearance of self-nucleic acids, and this will lead to production of type 1 interferons. And there will be self-antigen presentation to T cells by the major histocompatibility complex. And this leads to lymphocyte activation and signaling and defective T cell regulation. and production of feather antibodies. Lupus is a multisystemic disease, so meaning any organ can be involved, from neurological to renal involvement in a form of lupus nephritis to skin manifestation and hematological manifestation in a form of leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, antiphospholipid syndromes, or autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So since the first criteria was published in 1982, there have been development in the criteria. The reason being that we are trying to improve on the specificity and on the sensitivity. Currently, we are using the 2019 criteria, and its specificity is about 93%, and its sensitivity is about 96%. So it has an entry criteria. A patient is supposed to have an anti-nuclear antibody that is positive with a titers as low as 80. And when a patient has this ANA that is positive, then we look at the clinical domains or we look at the immunological domains. In terms of the clinical domains, we have fever, hematological manifestation, neuropsychiatric manifestation, mucocutaneous manifestation, serositis, where the lungs and the heart are involved, musculoskeletal, where the joints are involved, and renal. And in terms of immunological manifestations, it's the antiphospholipid antibodies and complement and lupus-specific antibodies, namely anti-double-stranded DNA and anti-SMID. So this criteria is a weighted criteria. So when a patient scores a score of 10 or more, then they can be classified as having lupus. In terms of the epidemiology, it is estimated that every lupus, in terms of the epidemiology, it's estimated that it's 5.1 per 100,000 people per year. And it has female predominance, mainly females of childbearing age between the ages of 15 and 45. And patients with lupus below the age of 40 were shown to have 52-fold higher risk of developing cardiovascular disease compared to their aged matched healthy peers. The burden of cardiovascular disease was 19-fold higher in people with lupus identified as Black people compared to white patients that had lupus. This Kaplan graph shows a survival analysis. It shows a span of 15 years where it predates 2 years before the diagnosis of SLE. It can be shown that in Black people, from the diagnosis of SLE, there is an acceleration in cardiovascular events and therefore less survival. All anatomic structures of the heart may be affected. It has been shown that patients that have anti-RHO that is positive, anti-LA that is positive, anticardiolipin that is positive, or double-stranded DNA are the ones that are prone to presenting with cardiovascular manifestations. When it comes to the pericardium, pericarditis is the most common manifestation. It's said that about 25% of 25% of all patients with lupus will develop pericarditis. They present as tachycardia, or they can present with positional chest pain and dyspnea. On auscultation, there is a friction rub. An echo finding may show a pericardial effusion. Thickened pericardium is a rare manifestation. An ECG shows PR depression and diffuse ST segment elevation. Tamponade and constrictive pericarditis are rare manifestation. The pericardial effusion is more exudative with neutrophil predominance, and it can be mistaken to that of an infection. And therefore, it's important when patients with lupus are presenting with pericarditis to exclude infection. Treatment can be corticosteroids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. Colchicine also has been shown to help with pericarditis. In terms of myocardium involvement, myocarditis, which is also very rare, its prevalence is about 8 to 25%. It has been shown to be more prevalent in African American ethnicity versus Hispanic and Caucasian ethnicity. Patients present with symptoms of heart failure. ECG shows diffuse ST and T wave abnormalities. They can present with cardiomegaly, and echo shows a hypokinesia, and MRI shows delayed gadolinium enhancement. In comparison to international literature, similar prevalence of 6.1 of lupus myocarditis was shown in Stellenbosch cohort in Cape Town. This was the cohort involved mixed race patient. And in their cohort, they showed that anti-RHO and anti-ribosomal P were more prevalent and were indicative of patients that will have myocardium involvement. In terms of valve, Lippmann sac endocarditis, also known as non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, is the common manifestation. Its prevalence is between 11 and 74%, and it commonly affects the mitral valve. And however, any other valve can be involved. Mitral prolapse have been seen in patients with lupus, and pulmonary hypertension, even though it's infrequent, it can be a serious complication. In terms of arrhythmias, patients with lupus can present with sinus tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, QT prolongation. QT prolongation, we see it mostly in patients that are on antimalarial therapy, hydroxychloroquine or plasmapheresis. Okay, in terms of coronary artery disease, in the Toronto lupus cohort, the mean age of myocardial infection was 49, compared to the general population where myocardial infection was only in patients who were between the ages of 65 and 74. Coronary artery disease was responsible for 30% of death in lupus patient. And SLE has been strongly linked to acceleration of atherosclerosis and increased cardiovascular mortality. This association can only be partially explained by the traditional Framingham cardiovascular risk, meaning that there are more disease-specific factors that drive atherosclerosis. So this slide just shows the Framingham score and that is used in the European population, namely systemic coronary risk for score. Both scores predict 10-year risk of developing cardiovascular diseases, and both scores involve age, gender, total cholesterol level, systolic blood pressures, smoking status. However, it's uncertain whether the systemic coronary risk evaluation can be applied in other populations. Even though some studies show that both models are effective in predicting the presence of coronary artery disease, and neither model showed a superiority over another. So, in terms of traditional risk factors, we mean major non-modifiable being age and gender. And those that are major and modifiable are blood pressure, lipid profile, glucose, and smoking. Other traditional risk factors in lupus patients include years of urbanization, years of education, marital status, alcohol use, history of premature or any established cardiovascular disease as type and as well as type 1 diabetes in their first degree relatives. In terms of non-traditional risk factors, they are more disease specific, so lupus activity, in terms of SLEDAI that I'll go more into, and lupus damage scores. Other comorbidities like smoke, stroke, infections, osteoporosis, peptic ulcer disease have also been shown to be risk factors for cardiovascular manifestation in lupus. Treatment as well, in treatment, we mean corticosteroids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, and other immune modulating therapy are also shown to be risk factors in developing cardiovascular diseases. Other disease-related risk factors include lupus nephritis, low serum complement level, antiphospholipid antibodies, anti-double-stranded DNA, anti-RHO, and old age at diagnosis of SLE, and longer duration of SLE, and longer duration of steroid therapy, high levels of oxidized low-density lipoprotein cholesterol and homocysteine. We have already said that in the pathophysiology of lupus, type 1 interferons are predominant, and this interfere with vascular repair in SLE patients. And this leads to production of adhesion molecules, leading to leukocyte adherence and penetration from the intima to the media of the wall, and leading to oxidization of low-density lipoprotein, foam formation, and interleukin-6 also have been shown to play a role in the atherosclerosis of lupus. This slide here depicts exactly what I've just said, leading to a carotid plaque. In some patients with lupus, it has been shown that they have high pulse wave velocity. High pulse wave velocity is a measure of arterial stiffness, and it has been correlated with a cardiovascular risk. In women with SLE without any cardiovascular event, the carotid intima thickness at baseline was predictive of future development of cardiovascular events. So, in terms of management, our conventional way of managing lupus has improved lupus disease activity. However, it hasn't improved the cardiovascular disease because they're still on the rise. And therefore, it's important to apply these three concepts, the non-pharmacological, pharmacological, and strict monitoring of disease progression. In terms of strict monitoring of disease progression, we use the SLEDAI 2K. This is also a weighted score, which involves 24 items, 16 being clinical and 8 being laboratory. The score ranges between 0 to 105, and the higher the score, the more active the patient, and scores of 6 have been shown to be consistent with high disease activity, therefore meaning that treatment has to be changed or treatment has to be added on. In terms of the sleep damage score, this was developed in 1996. It also shows irreversible damage of organ involvement in lupus, and it predicts future mortality in patients with lupus. So, in our management of patients with lupus, our aim is remission or low disease activity and prevention of flares. Patients with lupus are supposed to be on hydroxychloroquine, and it should not exceed 5 milligrams per kg. Glucocorticoids can be used in minimum doses of less than 7.5 and should be withdrawn as soon as possible. Appropriate initiation of immune modulating drugs such as methotrexate, azathioprine, and mycophenolate should be done. Belimumab is another is a biologic in lupus. Unfortunately, we don't have it in South Africa due to cost. It costs about $52,000 per year. It can be used in refractory patients or patients that are having organ-threatening involvement. So, in our setting, we use rituximab and cyclophosphamide. Okay, since the 1970s, it has always been said that lupus has a bimodal distribution. So early in the disease, we see activity, we see more infections, and later in the disease, it's activity, infections, and damage. With our conventional approach, we can see that damage still accelerates despite us giving patients treatment. Therefore, of late, even though lupus is a heterogeneous disease, however, treat-to-target models are being instituted to try and reduce acceleration of damage in this patient. According to EULAR recommendation on management of cardiovascular disease, they say hyperlipidemia should follow recommendation use according to general population. So meaning that by having a diagnosis of lupus doesn't mean that automatically you have to be on lipid-lowering medication. Low-dose aspirin as well is only used in patients who have cardiovascular risk profile. And according to EULAR, like I've said earlier, the aim should be low disease activity in order to reduce cardiovascular risk and treatment with lowest corticosteroid as possible. And there is no immunosuppressive medication that has been shown to be more cardiovascular protective. They also recommend that with every lupus patient, a calculation of a 10-year cardiovascular risk should be done at every clinic visit. And also a maintenance of blood pressure to be low. It has been recommended that it should be around 120 over 80. And it has been shown that systolic blood pressure is more important and more predictive of cardiovascular involvement. This was shown in the systolic blood pressure intervention trial. So when it comes to atorvastatin and intima media thickness, in APPLE study, where they had 221 patients with a mean age of 15, they were randomized to atorvastatin and placebo. At the end, there was no statistical difference in terms of intima media progression. However, there was a trend towards intima thickness reduction in those patients that were given atorvastatin. So, in terms of the immune modulatory therapies that we use, methotrexate, mycophenolate, cyclosporine, rituximab, they all have been shown to be neutral in terms of cardiovascular events. However, Cyclophosphamide and azathioprine, there has been conflicting evidence showing that they may contribute to cardiovascular events. Okay, so I thought I should talk about corticosteroids more, as rheumatologists are notorious of using it. So in theory, it has dual action. It has anti-inflammatory properties, and one would think is a good medication. But also, we know that it has adverse effects in terms of predisposing one to having hypertension, hyperglycemia, dyslipidemia, and obesity. And therefore, it should be used cautiously and sparingly. So, why should every patient with lupus, unless contraindicated, be on hydroxychloroquine? It is shown to have benefits in lipid profile. It has good glycemic control. It reduces risk of thrombovascular events. It prevents development of endothelial dysfunction, and it reduces carotid plaque burden. Vitamin D also is important in our treatment of our patients. Its deficiency has been linked to premature atherosclerosis. Diet also is important. Smoking is important. Not only smoking is a traditional risk factor, it also plays importance in the pathophysiology of lupus. Therefore, smoking cessation is important. So exercise has shown to enhance antioxidative process. It increases endothelial progenitor cells, and it increases endothelial nitric oxide synthase, and thereby boosting angiogenesis and therefore good endothelial growth. So I'm towards the end of my presentation. So I thought I should include this slide because it was actually the one that inspired me to do this presentation. This is a slide on rheumatoid arthritis in South African patients. Professor Solomon and Professor Desai have done extensive studies in patients that have rheumatoid arthritis in South Africa. And in the study, they've shown that carotid atherosclerosis burden was similar in Black patients as much as in white patients. They also showed that obese patients with rheumatoid arthritis, the obesity did not correlate to patients having atheroma or carotid plaques. And they also showed that kidney function is an independent association that predispose one to having atherosclerosis and endothelial activation in both Black patients and white African patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So, in conclusion, lupus is a complex disease, and it has a diverse and severe cardiac manifestation. It predisposes patients to having atherosclerosis. It's known to be an independent risk factor for endothelial dysfunction, and therefore treatment should aim at remission of signs and symptoms and prevention of damage and improvement of quality of life. Non-pharmacological management is important. So, my last question is, in this day, should we be using a carotid ultrasound in our clinics for every patient that comes, because it has been shown to be cost-effective and it's non-invasive and it predicts early development of cardiovascular manifestation in terms of atherosclerosis? Thank you. These are my references.